Because I knew I could be the best I can. I'd set myself in that and knew what I was capable of. But I found someone in the crew who needed help. And I worked with them over a long period of time. And at the critical moment found a very, very important thing to help him. And I enabled him to be the best he can. And watching that, I do watch that race sometimes. Watching that third 500 is probably one of the most satisfying moments of my rowing career because of the team element that I brought to it. We came together at that point in time as four quite individual athletes. I'd already at that stage been to four Olympic Games, and then Todd and Sam, I think, had been to two themselves, and Blair, who had not been to an Olympic Games, but was rising through. Again, different personalities. That person who's a hothead, real driver, hugely talented, a person who's just never say die attitude, even though he may not be the best physical specimen that's ever been created in the world of rowing. But then I've got this athlete who physically is exceptional, and his name's Blair. And some of the Tassie coaches will probably know who I'm talking about here, and that's okay. Blair is an exceptional athlete. He is one of the strongest, powerful athletes I've ever rode with. And I absolutely mean that. I've rode with a lot of athletes in my time. He's the strongest one I've ever rode with. I think he produced a 6.08, I think, for a 2K ergo as a lightweight rower. Amazing. When he's on, unstoppable. But he can have a bad day, and he can have a really bad day. So we come together first week of training. We're all over the place. Your school crews, your junior crews would be beating us. We actually could not get the blades off the water. I kid you not, we could not get the blades off the water. All right? And that started the tone. So we would have sessions where we'd start like that and we'd have to stop. Let's roll in some pairs. Let's combine and work it out. And so I'd go and so I'd go. And you get into the last kilometre of the row and we'd get about, half a dozen good strokes or 500 metres of good stuff, and in we go, and we'd say, oh, geez, we started off pretty bad, but look, that bit was good. Let's see if we can start there tomorrow. Come down tomorrow, phew, here we are again. And it just kept going like that. And it got to the point where it got completely frustrating for us all, coach included. And I started to realise that it was all starting to push back onto Blair. And I thought about everyone in the crew, and I thought, well, Sam's the hothead. He just wants to win at all costs, and he's not going to stop and pause and try and help this situation. Skippy's just going to keep driving, doesn't want to deal with it. The personalities don't join. And, coach is too busy looking after the program and making sure what's going on, and is trying his best to work through it, but he's getting a bit stuck. So I took him on. So I started having a cup of coffee with him. I started to get to know him. Working out what was going on. After a session, let's go and grab some lunch, and what you think? Oh, yeah, it's a bit frustrating, and start to get that side of it. And as time went on, I was slowly getting to know him, but I wasn't really getting to know him. I was just trying to work through the issues and learning. And sometimes we'd actually, we'd grab a cuppa and talk about his family and talk about his last holiday and all that. Wouldn't actually talk about it, I was trying to get to know him, and it got to the stage where we went overseas and competed. And the other two guys in the crew go, Eddie, you're with Blair. Like, they'd actually give me the keys and go, you're with Blair, That's how it got to. I was always rooming with Blair everywhere we went. And it was more so when we were overseas, I started to realise more about Blair. So we'd come in after a training session. Blair would walk in the room, he'd go straight to the shower, have his shower, He'd put his skins on, full tilt skins, on the bed, music on with the mental imagery, boom. Now, kid you know, you can put the stopwatch on it for 20 minutes, right, off you go for the rest of the day. You go to the supermarket with Blair, and you go to the supermarket, you want to go and get 5 items, you end up getting 15, all right? Blair goes to the supermarket, he goes to get 3 items, He goes to get three items. Boom, aisle three, there. Aisle two, there. And so on, and out, and he's gone. All right, so this guy is just very straight down the line. He's incredibly powerful, all right? So I'm starting to realize and starting to see the behavior and the characteristic of this guy. He's a fantastic bloke. I became a great mate with him, and we still are. And I started to understand him. And I guess when I came back to the boat, I can see those frustrations and what was going on. So when I think about that supermarket situation, when someone says, feel for the catch, it means nothing to Blair, because he doesn't understand that. He's like, blade, go, get your blade in quick at the catch. Whoop! It would go in quick, so much so, Lord Jesus, right? You need to tap down a bit more, Blair. Boom! All right? So you're getting the idea of what this guy's like, all right? So hence we'd have sessions that were fabulous and sessions that were stretched out. So we just, you know, I just kept working with it. I figured I couldn't change that behaviour, that characteristic, but understanding it was the best way to do it so that at race time we'd be right. Now we'd raced overseas in Europe and, look, I can't remember the results, but I don't think we rode in the final. I think we were seventh and eighth and ninth or something like that sort of thing. I knew we had the capabilities of doing something pretty well, though. That was my belief all the way. I knew we had the right people because Blair's the strongest bloke I've ever come across. Sam Belts is equally one of the most talented athletes I've ever seen, equal to the likes of Bruce Hick, Hamish Koresh, Son Burgess, you know, a number of them, all right? So I knew it was there in this crew, but I'd identified, I guess, a link in the crew that wasn't connecting well, and I engaged in trying to find a way to empower him into the crew, all right? So we've got the World Championships. We're coming into the World Championships. We start off in the heat, and off we race. We come fourth. You come fourth in the heat, you're thinking, it's not looking good. I think we're looking at C final here. So yeah, we talked about it, got together straight away, worked through the discussions, realised, you know, we pretty much got to the 750 mark and we lost our patterning. Had a good start, through the five well, lost our patterning. So of course you can imagine where the discussion went, you know, Blair, you know, you lost it, sort of thing. So again, let's work through. So let's hold on to it, find that rhythm, keep on that rhythm and flow to the thousand, make sure we then get the push. So we've rock up into the ripper charge, first two through the semi-final, rest eliminated. We're sitting, going well to the 1,000, have a nice push, real focus for us in that race. Push out to a half a length on the Italians. Fell away. Italians got through us at 1,500. We actually came second. So we came second. We've made it to the semi-finals. We're the 12th slowest in the field of the semi-finalists. But we've made the semis after coming fourth in the heat and second in the repercharge. All right, semi-final time, thinking, this is really the final. This is it. Top three, go through. Bottom three, see you later. See you next year sort of thing. So again, we focused on making sure we could be the best we can in the third 500, holding to the 1,000, see if we can hold strong to the 1,500, back ourselves, our abilities, all these sorts of things. Long story, race the semi-final. We're sitting fourth with 200 metres to go. And I remember this moment, this moment is as vivid as I can ever imagine it. I looked across, we're that far behind the Swiss who are sitting in third, and I just yelled out to my loudest as I could, I just said, how much do you want it? And we just dug deep, and it was painful, it was rough, it was rugged, but we pushed 20 strokes and we got through and we beat the Swiss by that much. All right, we just made the World Championship final after coming fourth in the heat. So I was ready to stand up in the boat and go, you beauty. All right, because I knew what I'd gone through with the crew and where we'd got it to and what we'd come through from the start. So here we are, we've got, a day off and getting ready for the final. And Blair's gone back to the room and he's put his, skins on. All right, walk time. I know him now. I know him. I've got him sussed out. I'm chatting to him and we actually got talking about the Penrith Cup. And we're talking about the Penrith Cup in 2009 up at Lake Barrington. And I said, because I wasn't in it that particular year. And he said, you're racing WA and went through the 1,000 together from memory. And it was almost dead heat on the line type of thing. It was an unbelievable race. Were you guys in front at the 1,000 FA? And he's like, I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? What, half a length? What, you down? What, none? No, I don't know. Oh, well, what about 1,500? Because I didn't see 1,500. What, I don't know. And it just dawned on me then, I realised, he's too busy focusing here that he doesn't see anywhere else. He doesn't have that lateral vision that he can't see beyond it. He's too busy thinking about hands down, tap, belly, didn't get followed. His brain is going, all right? So I realised a massive thing on that moment. So I then said to him, all right, Blair, when we race this final, if I tell you where we are, will that help? And he should have seen his eyes. He looked at me and went, So, I reckon I'm on something here. All right. So I had a chat to him there and I said, all right, look, I'll just work you through the race. All right. Yep, beauty. And I said, now, one bit I wanted, and this is, I guess, a little specific thing I worked on there in the third five, because I knew his ability. I knew how strong he was. I said, now, it's going to be close, right? So when we go through that 12:50, I just want you to give your best 20 strokes. Give us your best 20 you can. And then I want you just to clear your head for 10, because you know that Sam's going to be calling us all the way to the line from there. Up, 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 go. All right? Yeah. All right. Beauty. So I went in the room next door. Hi, Sam. Hi, Skippy. Just discovered something. I'm going to be chatting to Blair during the race, right? I'm just going to work with him, right? Stick to the plan. But a couple of times I'm just going to say a few things to Blair, just confidence things, really. Nothing, it'll be just confidence, giving him lots of push and drive, all right? Now, I'll take you through this final and I'll show you how it'll unfold and try and talk you through the race, all right? Remember, we came fourth in the heat, second in the repercharge, and third in the semi-final, scratched him. We're meant to come dead stone last. So switch it on to the lightweight four, Ken. See if we can just get it straight out of the blocks if we can. It was actually the most relaxed I'd been sitting in the start. I remember sitting there because I thought, in my own mind, I thought, well, if Blair's on today, we'll go bloody well. If he's not, it'll be what it'll be. How far back in sixth is where we'll end up. So I actually felt pretty relaxed and pretty settled in my mind. I remember looking across at the crews in the lanes beside you and under that tension and stuff, and I was like, I'm fine. Blair's in the 3C. So Germany were the world champions at the time. This was the emergence of China. China had won the World Cup. We're basically World Cup champions for that particular year. Great Britain medalling previous years. Italy are always forever strong. Netherlands actually had two brothers who are twins, the Muller brothers, who had won the World Under 23 Championship coming into the four. Maybe just go forward, Ken, if you can, just straight into the race. I was in the bow. Those guys were the world champions. These guys are the World Cup champions for that year. Maximum heart rate, really. as in heart rate at the end of the race. This was the category that Britain were successful in 2007. Oh, God, no, I wouldn't have a clue. And then the maximum. Yeah, high. Well, I hope I was high, otherwise I'd be doubting myself. So yeah, Blair's in the three seat there. Got Todd Skipworth in stroke, Blair in three, Sam in two, and I'm in the bow seat. It's quite a difficult weather too. It's actually a side bounce, so we're actually in the worst lane, being the slowest qualifiers. So I knew in my mind, in the first 10 strokes, we're either going to have a good race or not. By about now, I knew we were going to have a good race. So I thought, oh, here we go, we're on. So hence, good start. No, through here, so again, as you can see, pretty good start. Moved out with the Poms, who we knew were always fast starters. Yeah, we're just down in closest to the screen. So we've just gone through 250 there, and I just went 250. Yeah, nice work. Just to let Blair know, through 250. Blair's, Sam's actually calling the race from the two seat, so quite a structured race plan that we had there. So it's from the 250 to the 500. You're really trying, you know, you're up at 40 plus. You're really trying to find your rhythm, find your length, set yourself in as you over that next 250 metres. So that's what we're trying to achieve in this 250. These men really making the boat sing in the first 500 metres. Coming towards the end of the first quarter, furthest away, it's so Sam's just called just up at the catches. So we're focusing up at the front on the catches. And I just went, yeah, after that, I went, yeah, we're through 500, nice work, nice catch, Blair. Martin referred to yesterday, just carrying that black ribbon in memory of one of Britain's absolute greats. Yeah, I'm looking. Yeah, I also gave, a couple of points in that race, I gave a bit of feedback. Just said, you know, we're up there, we're moving well, we're up the front. Yeah, just where I could get it out without saying too much. You've really got to go out quick in this race. It's so competitive. And this is the state of play with 1,250 metres to go. That good start. Now, the funny thing about this race, no one was really looking at us the whole time. Everyone's waiting for us to drop off. So, the focus was on the guys in the middle and what was happening on the other side of the course, especially with the Germans. Such a competitive race. We can see the blades of the Dutch crew alongside the Britons, British down at 34.5. And of course the Chinese, now there's the bow of... All right, so we're really focusing on good rhythm, good platform. I'm just giving those yes, moving well, backing up everything Sam's saying here. I've called us through that, 750, yeah, nice work. Yeah, just so Blair knows that we've gone through the 250, gone through the 500, gone through the 750. Now, by just saying that, we're still in the race. Remember, we came fourth in the heat, right? Now, we're meant to fall off here. Everyone thought we're just going to fall apart, and this is where we're meant to die. We're not meant to be where we are. Yep. So this is where... Not yet. This is where we're doing a push. We're working the leg drive. We're holding the finishes, and we're calling each other and saying, "Yep, nice work, good stuff, working well." Blair knew where he was here. He was through the 1,000. Nah. Yeah, now we've come through the 12, I think I might have missed here, but we've come through the 1250, here it is, through 1250. And this is where it is, this is where we should disappear, all right? Now I spoke to Blair and I said, give us your best 20 and then clear your head for 10, all right? Now I can tell you, he made this boat move. This is our world championship here, this 30 strokes right now. This is him being the best he can. He's making that number six stay right there in the race. We're going with him, and I'm backing up going, yeah, Blair, you're moving well. Great stuff, all that sort of stuff. And he's just head down. He is doing what he knows he's capable of. We should be five lengths back. Blair's just put us in the race. All right, now I'll just say, we're in there. So now Sam's like, hothead, says, here we go. And he starts calling it up, and the action starts. And so up we go. And as Sam called it up, and it's obviously, you know, anyone, you've all raced last 500s of a 2K race, it's pretty exciting stuff, and this was a pretty exciting finish. Sam's calling us up every 10 strokes, pushing up. And I'm just working away going, yes, nice, every time, right? And just giving confidence back. Nice, Blair, go again, give it to him, nice. And I've just kept working away. I knew Skippy and Beltsy didn't necessarily need me to talk to them because they knew Blair was on. When you're 250 to go and you're sitting at this part of the race, it's really just, you're into it. It's just all legs down, push, away you go. It's all that kind of adrenaline that comes. It's all the excitement that you set yourself up for. He would. So that was the race. No one knew who won. That was when the Poms found out, because it came up on the sideboard next to it. They won. We were second by 0.07 of a second, which is the number. And the Chinese, who came home with a roaring finish, were 0.01 behind us. So there was 0.08, I think it was, between first, second and third. And the Germans, the world champions, were 0.4 behind us. So yeah, it was a ridiculous finish. But the big thing, thanks Ken, you'll probably flick that one off. And yes, I did stand up in the boat that day. It was actually the first time I'd ever stood up in a boat. So I see that as a personal sense of achievement, because I knew I could be the best I can. I'd set myself in that and knew what I was capable of. But I found someone in the crew who needed help. And I worked with them over a long period of time. And at the critical moment found a very, very important thing to help him, and I enabled him to be the best he can. And watching that, I do watch that race sometimes. Watching that third 500 is probably one of the most satisfying moments of my rowing career because of the team element that I brought to it.
And what did the other boys say? Were they like, thank God you figured
that out? Yeah, it was a pretty special moment, I think, you know, like whenever you medal at a world championships. I mean, you know, God, it would have been nice to just hang on and be that much on the other side of it. But I think, you know, to be standing on the podium at a world championships is fantastic at any point in time, especially at an event like the lightweight four, or what it was in its day. And you can tell by the finish, you know, it's an incredibly close race and it's unpredictable who's going to be on particular days. So yeah, huge satisfaction. I think, you know, personally for me, it was, you know, returning back after an Olympic cycle and coming in and setting up for the London Olympics, and that actually enabled us to then move on. 2011 we won the World Championship, went on the Olympic Games, finished fourth unfortunately, but that became the building blocks of what we were able to work on for the next couple of years.
Did the other guys in your crew need to understand Blair in that way too, or you found
Yeah, no, it's a good question. They couldn't deal with him. They'd come up to me and said, I can't deal with him. So I knew that. They'd actually vented that to me and I said, it's all right, I'll work with
it.
It
wasn't important for the whole group to get there. It was just important that someone did.
In the end, I think that someone embraced him and empowered him. Didn't need to be anyone, yeah. And they knew. And there was times when they actually came to me and, you know, they'd vent their frustration. So, yep, thanks, you know. And they knew, because they knew I was going and having a walk with Blair, walking back from the shed. You know, just those quiet moments where they've gone to the change room and Blair's just sitting there thinking that session through, and I've gone over and gone, you're right, mate? How are you? And off you go and have a 5-minute chat, you know. It's just those little moments that empowered him, to make him know that, you know, I had his back and he was okay.
It's been interesting, yeah, that not everyone needed to get in, but just someone in.
And so even as the coach, Brett, who was the coach, you know, he was challenged by it. Because, you know, he likes to think technique and he was putting the work into us and, you know, but there's this element that was really hard. And trust me, he was having trouble with the other guys. Like, Sam was a hothead. They had their moments as well. So, you know, there was other issues there that we work with, and you have that. But he knew I was working with Blair, so he trusted me and my experience to be able to work with that.
How old was Blair?
I don't know. I mean, he's relatively, I guess, from an international athlete point of view, he'd had time in the under-23s, starting to hit his straps, I suppose, and coming into the picture, but probably hadn't had a breakthrough. That was probably his breakthrough race, to be honest.
Yeah. How much did the crew change between then and 2012?
Well, the following year, and I guess when you win a world championship, you have an exceptional crew. Blair just missed out on that crew that following year. Someone like Ben Kiridan comes back into the crew after 3 Olympic Games and won a few Olympic medals and World Championship medals along the way. He's a pretty tough customer to beat. So he was, but a hugely competitive selection trials. I mean, I was seat racing Blair, so it was pretty competitive, and he certainly kept us honest. But in 2011, we won the lightweight 4. Blair was in the 8 that won the lightweight 8 World Championship, so it was an amazing year. Yeah.
Did Blair, did he get it from that? Did he get it?
Good question. I watched Blair from the outside, I guess. I still kept in touch with him, but when you're in a crew environment where it's really, you know, at that level, you're trying to do the best you can for your crew and work with your crew. I'd touch base, how's it going and things like that, but I couldn't nurture him day by day. And I saw the struggles that he went through in other crews that he went on with, namely from, I guess, 2012 to 16, the lightweight 4. I think it was the crew in 2013, 2014, I think it was, he was in. Yeah, had their struggles and things like that. And I was like, yeah, it was kind of hard because I could see what was happening and I just couldn't be in it to help it.
Is he autistic?
Possibly.
We have autistic kids in our club and they are hard work. It's funny, he rode in that Z8 last year and he did on your role. He actually...
Yeah. So sorry, he did learn something.
Yeah. He was the youngest in the crew, and Blair took on the mentor role for the whole season. And pretty much after every race, Blair was the one who spoke up. He was the one that, yeah, he knew how they should race, and he understood every 500 what they should be doing. So he must learn something along the line.
Yeah, that was fantastic to hear, actually. That's really good.
Just wondering, you obviously took this role to work this out and fix this situation, but did your coach not help you with that?
No, I worked with him, and while I was chatting to Blair, I'd be having lots of conversations with Brett as well, you know, and if you think, again, as a coach, let's get the blade in quick at the catch. So Blair's getting the blade in quick. Make sure we tap down the finish, Blair, clean finish. All right, flow away a bit quicker. So now he's thinking quick legs, Blair. Right, so there's all this stuff going on. And I remember a couple of times where I said the Brett after a session, just said, just slow it down a little bit for Blair. I reckon you just gave him a bit too much. And he'd be like, oh yeah, okay, cheers. Just something simple as that. Because I sort of knew he was struggling with it. And you can only do that if you understand your athletes. You know, you understand their capabilities and what they can handle. Usually you should only focus on one thing as a crew for a session, and that's your focus sort of thing. But, you know, you've got your individual points too. But, yeah, you don't want to load them up too much. There's a lot going on there. the physical effort and all those sort of things, a lot going on. So, you know, the old keep it simple principle, take that as a coach too, and how you work with the individuals and understand them. Yeah. All right. Oh, yeah.
Working with junior crews, what would you recommend to sort of combat your role with your crew? How would you manage the situation with junior athletes, trying to manage that? It's hard to ask a junior athlete to do that with another junior athlete.
Yeah, well, that's probably working with people probably more in the adult area, but you know, within reason. Main thing would be to get to know them. You know, get to know why they're doing it. Have you ever asked them, what do you row? You know, what are you doing it for? You know, what do you love about it? Just use those when they're washing the boat down to have a chat to them. You know, don't always talk about technique, because you know technique's only one element of it, really. You know, talk about them and get to know them. I mean, especially like 13 and 14 year olds, they got all sorts of things going on. But
they do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep, that's right.
If you just mention, just at this point, just say a few words to such and such.
Mm. And I think then, you know, you've got the different people. Use the knowledge that you can to learn about them as people, so that at the right time you can empower them to be the best they can.